I understand basically everything about the popularity and ubiquity of The Hunger Games, except that people think it's good. I get that Jennifer Lawrence is a real deal long-term movie star blossoming right before our eyes. I know that we're psyched to see kids and teenagers getting into a big multimedia franchise that's all about economic disparity and class struggle. And yes, I get that Catholic Fancy Feast is a way better projected self-image for young women than Bella Swan. Agreed, agreed, all of the above agreed. But we all saw that cheesy, incomprehensible, TV movie-level slog that was the first movie, right? Well, in case you've forgotten, this is our premise. At some point in the near future, or maybe an alternate timeline, it's kind of unclear, civilization is divided between the rich and poor classes who've elected to organize themselves into the laziest possible visual references for rich and poor classes. The evil capital, which fashions itself after Caligula's Rome, and the good districts, which fashion themselves after Depression-era working-class stereotypes. In order to suppress rebellion, the capital forces the districts to offer up dual child tributes to participate in a yearly winner-take-all televised blood sport called the Hunger Games. The Hunger Games are only supposed to have one winner, ensuring that every district loses at least one kid no matter who wins, but in our first movie, capitalist Benverine and her platonic male buddy Pooter Melmac pretend to be a couple in order to sway the capital audience into showing them both mercy, a scheme complicated by Cuttlefish already having a boyfriend back home and Pizza actually having a for real crush on her. As Catching Fire opens, the duo are on their whirlwind stage-managed victory tour as the capital's newest pet celebrities, but it becomes clear that many citizens of the district saw right through the pretend romance and have begun to venerate Cutlass Halloween as an icon of subterfuge and revolution. In response, the capital's new game maker, Pluto Nash, contrives that the next Hunger Games will be an all-stars match with a pool of combatants called from former winners, meaning that Codfish and Peasoup will have to go back into the grinder against seasoned veterans. And you know what? That all adds up to a pretty damn effective checklist of ways to fix what was wrong with the first movie. The Victory Tour is a much more direct and organic way to engage the satire of reality TV celebrity distraction culture. They've got a new director who actually knows how to do action and use a tripod, but best of all, having most of the other combatants be experienced fighters and mostly older folks who've all had time to hone interesting individual personalities and skills is a perfect stakes raising from just having Catspaw versus a bunch of anonymous shabby ragamuffins last time. I mean, check out this lineup. You got an aggro brother-sister team, you got two goth kids who do camouflage, you got a chick who files her teeth into fangs so she can bite people to death, you got an old woman who rides around on the back of a kinda sleazy young dude who has a goddamn trident, you got Jeffrey Wright as a smart-ass tech genius guy who kills people with science, you even got Jenna Malone as the evil riot girl version of Catalyst who fights with an axe because she's from the lumberjack tribe or something. I mean, holy crap, yeah, it kinda means we're doing the first movie again, right down to the magic dresses pageant and the chariots and the training and all that business, but who cares? We've got all these badass new characters. Francis Lawrence is gonna at least make it look cool as hell, so hell yeah, let's get this motherfucker going. Nah, just kidding. Once they get to the Hunger Games, they do a little bit of fighting, they run from some magic acid fog, they run from some killer monkeys, they run from some magic mess-with-your-head birds, but for the most part, Catapult and her improv team of allies spend most of the games hiding while all those potentially fun new characters get killed off-screen. No, seriously. I mean, they change it up. First they're hiding in the woods, then they're hiding on a beach, then they're hiding in a different part of the woods, but it really is just a lot of sitting around and marking time until it can all end abruptly in a brand new all-time champion anti-climax, so we can get a cheeky lead-in for To Be Continued. I don't know, guys. I know I'm supposed to like these movies, and they aren't fully bad, and I really want to like these movies, but we're halfway through now, and I'm just not feeling it. I like the cast, I like the basic ideas behind it all, but this is two swings and a miss as far as I'm concerned. More problematically, all the interesting stuff it does make me think about is generally to the franchise's greater detriment. I'm still not getting how the capital can generate weather, biological matter, up to and including animals, and whole ecosystems artificially at the push of the button for the games, but for some reason need to keep everyone in the districts around as a free labor force. It's kind of odd how Cataract is still set up as this supremely badass heroine when she spends most of the first hour of this movie fainting and sobbing and breaking down mid-action so much you half expect Adam Malkovich to show up and go, okay, fine, you can use the bow now, Merida. And here's the other weird thing. I get that our big overarching class metaphor here is ancient Rome feeding Christians to lions in the Colosseum, but it's kind of odd that the good guys are all these steely, impossibly noble, good old-fashioned, salt-of-the-earth normal folks associated with traditional blue-collar, honest days work professions like farming and mining and hunting, while the main signifier that the capital folks are evil is that they're all fey and foppish and overdressed or overly fashion conscious, and even the men wear makeup, ew. Like there's one bad guy who's actually a good guy, and you know who it is because he's the guy wearing the least makeup out of all the bad guys. I'm not saying there's some kind of anti-this or anti-that message purposefully coded into Hunger Games. That would be kind of stupid given its broader textual and subtextual intentions, but that's kind of why this bit of discourse sticks out, and it's why you need to actually think through the use of visual actual shorthand when you're aiming for metaphor. The series' big thematic metaphor is all about class struggle and wealth disparity and all the other last shall be first occupy type stuff, but its visual metaphors often land on the exact opposite side, to the extent that from certain vantage points it can feel like we're supposed to be rooting for Sailor Scout Ted Nugent here to lead an armed incursion against San Francisco. Or maybe that's just my mind wandering. I mean, I had plenty of time for it, they really do just seem to be sitting around waiting for Act 3 forever. See you next time!